Well, good morning. Good morning. If we could move in here and get started. This is a union session that's looking for Arctic effects that are interacting. That's one reason why the signals are big in the Arctic. I like to point out this is a AGU union session, but it was organized by the Polar Research Board, the International Arctic Science Committee, and the International Arctic Research Center. And I also want to point out that we have a really nice poster session after lunch today. I encourage you all to come down and talk with your colleagues there. It will be in the union session of the posters, which is on the far left end of the poster hall. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jim and we'll get started.
You bring up the first talk. Bring it up here. I should say that I am Jim White. I'm the chair of the Polar Research Board, and on behalf of the Polar Research Board of the National Academies, we welcome all of you. The first talk today will be from Marieke Holland, and I'll turn it over to you, Marieke.
All right. So we're going to have to go back a couple slides. Whoops. Ah, sorry. I'm just trying to get to the start. Yep. All right. You get to see all my slides before I start. Hi, so I'm Marieke Holland, and I'm going to be talking today about some climate model simulations and the 20th and 21st century Arctic sea ice. In the CCSM-4 model, and the role of changing seasonality in the sea ice and how that influences the surface albedo feedback. And apparently I'm having a little problem with my pointer.
Would you like to use the mouse then?
Yeah, so I might end up, okay. I'll try and point to things with the mouse, so hopefully it'll go smoothly. So the motivation for this, of course, is the fact that we're seeing these very dramatic changes happening in the Arctic sea ice system. This shows the time series of September ice extent over the satellite record through 2011. And we're seeing these very large reductions in sea ice cover. We're seeing a thinning of the ice pack, earlier melt onset dates. So this coherent picture of Arctic sea ice change has emerged. And I'd like to note that while the most dramatic changes we're seeing in the ice cover are happening in September, and associated with that are large sea ice albedo changes, as shown in this lower left panel. There we go. So you see these large trends in surface albedo, particularly large in September, as shown here. This is from some climate modeling results. The changes in the net shortwave, the trends in the net shortwave are actually not going to be largest in September because the sun is quite low at this time, even though you have these large ice area losses and large albedo changes. So instead, this shortwave trends from, again, coupled model results are largest in June, where there's a smaller albedo change, but that's acting on a much higher solar insolation. So understanding these changes earlier in the melt season are pretty important for understanding the surface albedo feedback and being able to project changes in the sea ice into the future. So in order to look at these effects, I'm going to be showing some model simulations from the Community Climate System Model version 4. So this is a configuration of the Community Earth System Model. And it's particularly useful for looking at these kind of changes in surface albedo because the sea ice model has some new capabilities, including a multiple scattering shortwave radiative transfer, a melt pond parameterization, in which the ponds are a function of the surface meltwater flux, and we also now include things like the deposition and cycling of aerosols. So this means that we have a much more realistic treatment of surface albedo. And the model simulates a very good late 20th century sea ice climatology. This shows the coupled model results from CCSM4 for March and September here on the bottom. This is the ice concentration averaged over the late 20th century compared to the satellite observations. And you can see the model has a very good simulation of the ice edge, has a very good simulation of the annual cycle of ice extent, and it has a reasonable sea ice loss over the late 20th century. So this shows from 1950 to 2005 here, which are the as long as the 20th century runs go, compared to the observations. And the ensemble members from the model bracket the trend in the observed ice loss from 1975 to 2005. So the model is consistent with what's happening in the observed record. The model also simulates the seasonality of the sea ice very well. And for this, we're looking at what I'll refer to as seasonal triggers. So these are the timing of melt onset, the timing of the freeze-up, and the melt season length. And we're comparing these to satellite-derived estimates of melt onset, shown here on the left panels. This is the CCSM-4 climatology. And this is the distribution of the two, so the fractional area of melt onset dates shown here on the x-axis. So the model also simulates a very good representation of these seasonal triggers, the onset of melting, as shown here. If anything, the melt onset in the model is a little bit earlier than these estimates from the satellite observations. But they're probably within the uncertainty of this comparison because, of course, what the satellite's sensing aren't exactly the same thing as what the model's simulating for melt onset. This shows the same thing for freeze onset dates. And again, the model simulates a very reasonable representation, both spatially and the average values, of the freeze onset as compared to these satellite observations. If anything, the model's a little bit earlier, so it looks like the model melt season is shifted slightly earlier than what we see in the Marcus et al. Data. And because we get a reasonable representation of the melt onset and the freeze onset, the melt season lengths are also well represented in the model. So this is important because we're trying to understand how these seasonal triggers influence the albedo evolution over the melt season and in turn influence the albedo feedback. And we do see indications that the onset of melting in the model has an important role in the net shortwave budgets. So this shows regression analysis. This is from a pre-industrial control run, so there's no changes in external forcing. This is using 155 years of output, and it's basically for 1850 climate conditions. So here we're just looking at the natural variability as simulated by the model. And what we see is that melt onset, earlier melt onsets lead to larger increases in the shortwave absorption in June and July. So this just shows a scatter plot of the June data for the net shortwave versus the melt onset date. So what we're seeing in these pre-industrial control simulations is that for a one day earlier melt onset, we get about a watt per meter squared increase in the absorbed shortwave in June, and something similar in July as well. So we are seeing this albedo changes associated with the melt onset that are leading to enhanced heating of the surface. We also see relationships with the melt season length and the freeze onset. These are probably due to the fact that the melt season length and the freeze onset are actually influenced by when the melt onset occurs. So it really looks like the melt onset is the driving factor here. So that shows results from pre-industrial control simulations looking at the interannual variability. But of course, one of the things we're very interested in is how the sea ice is going to evolve in the future and what the albedo feedback, what role that might play. So this shows climate simulations, again from CCSM-4, the ensemble mean September ice extent from 1980 to 2100 is shown in black. The gray shading shows the range across the ensemble members. And in this model, subject to the RCP 8.5 forcing scenario for the 21st century, the model reaches near ice-free conditions in September around 2070. And there's a whole host of other changes in the sea ice and Arctic climate associated with this, and I'd refer you to this paper led by Steve Vavras here for some of those other changes occurring in the Arctic climate system. Associated with those changes in sea ice are also changes in the seasonal triggers. This shows the melt onset time series. This is averaged over the Arctic basin from 1850 through to 2100 here. So we are seeing earlier melt onsets across the Arctic basin. The trend in that over the 21st century is about 2 days earlier onset per decade. This shows a trend map, and so you can see that those changes across the Arctic basin are not uniform. You're getting some regions where you're seeing much earlier melt onset dates, in particular in the Barents Sea region, but in general throughout the Arctic basin, it's something like 2 to 10 days earlier melt onset per decade over the 21st century. We're also seeing in the climate model that the freeze onset is happening later, and this means that we're getting longer melt season lengths occurring over the 21st century. Now, these things are important because they influence things like the melt pond onset, the melt pond concentrations, and because this model actually has a melt pond parameterization, we can look at the role of those effects. So what we see, what I'm showing here is the radiative forcing associated with melt ponds on the Arctic sea ice from 1900 to 2100 as a function of month. So this is the influence of the ponds on the net shortwave absorption in the model simulation. And what we see over the 21st century is that the melt ponds increase in terms of their overall concentrations, and they also shift to earlier in the season. And this is very consistent with those earlier melt onset dates. So we get an enhanced shortwave absorption associated with this enhanced ponding. So by the end of the 21st century, the ponds account for something like 10 watts per meter squared, enhanced shortwave absorption in June, in July here, and you're starting to see some large increases in June as well. So this is one of the implications of those changes in the melt onset dates. There are others. There are other changes in the sea ice surface state that are associated with that earlier melt onset, like an earlier snow loss and albedo changes associated with that. So the question is, are these things important in the overall budgets? And we can, again, diagnose that from the climate model simulation. So this shows the changing net shortwave budgets. This is just averaged over the Arctic Ocean, over the Arctic sea ice, well, over the Arctic Ocean, including the ice and open ocean regions. The black line here shows the net shortwave, so the you can see increases happening in the net shortwave over the 21st century. And there are two factors that go into that. So there's actually reductions in the incoming shortwave, the solar insolation at the surface, associated with larger cloud amounts as you move into the future. But that's balanced by the fact that you have these decreases in surface albedo, so you have a larger absorption. So basically, the red and green lines here add up to the black line. So we can further diagnose this change in the surface albedo into its different components. So I've added two lines now onto the plot, these two different blue lines. The dark blue line is the change in the net shortwave budget that's associated with a change in the sea ice state itself. So not the ice to open water contrast, but instead the changes in the surface albedo of the ice cover. And you see that that increases considerably over the 21st century. And it's actually larger than the other blue line, which I'll get to in a second, at least over most of the 21st century. And so that's because we're moving from an ice cover that looks like this for a lot of the melt season or for a lot of the year to an ice cover that looks more like this. And you can see that this ice cover has a lot lower surface albedo overall. Now that other line that I've added, the light blue line here, is actually the change in the surface albedo associated with the changing ice area. So the fact that as you move into the future, you're losing sea ice, and that ice to open water has a very large surface albedo contrast, as you can see in this lower figure. Now, it's interesting that that effect on the net shortwave budgets is comparable to the effect from the changes in the sea ice state itself. And that's because of the timing at which these different changes occur and its relationship to the solar insolation cycle. So to conclude, over the 21st century, simulated sea ice seasonal triggers do change significantly. This is consistent with the observed changes that we're seeing. So we're seeing in the 21st century, our climate model simulations suggest an earlier melt onset, a later freeze-up, a longer melt season. This is consistent with earlier and more extensive simulated ponding. And that, combined with other effects, such as the earlier snow loss over the sea ice, contributes to enhanced shortwave heating. And the main take-home message from this is that these processes that are happening on the sea ice surface play as large a role in the net shortwave budgets and the increases in those shortwave budgets as reductions in the ice area. So these changes in the sea ice state, the surface state of the sea ice, must be considered in albedo feedback studies. And I'd argue that these are the kind of things that we need to include in our climate models if we're going to accurately simulate the albedo feedback. And just to note that these new capabilities in the CCSM4 at least allow us to start to investigate and quantify these effects, although further improvements can definitely be made in how we represent some of these processes. And finally, I'm just going to leave you with a list of references. This new CCSM4 model has just recently been released, and there are there's a host of papers coming out, some of which are already published, many of which are in a special collection of the Journal of Climate, and I'd refer you to those for more details. So with that, I'll take any questions. I think I have 4 minutes for seconds. If I have time for questions, which I'll leave to these guys.
Is there one quick question? We can't see up here. Go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, so we do see very large interdecadal variability in this model. Now, on the 30-year time scale, one of our ensemble members is actually more extreme, has a larger ice loss trend than what's observed. The other five ensemble members have a lower ice loss. But the natural variability could be playing a very dominant role in the observed ice loss. We do see very large natural variability in the model, and I think it argues that we really need more than six ensemble members from a climate model such as this to compare to the observed record. And we're trying to do more ensemble members to further investigate those kinds of effects.
Thank you very much, Marika. The next speaker is Michael Steele, the Arctic Ocean's response to and role in sea ice retreat.
Okay, good morning. Thanks to the organizers of this session for inviting me to give this talk. So I'm going to be talking about the ocean, and my collaborators are listed there on the lower left. Sea ice is retreating, and as a result, the upper ocean is warming. These panels show you September sea ice cover and the anomaly of summertime sea surface temperature as diagnosed by satellite data. The anomaly relative to some longer-term mean. And so you can see in the first couple of years somewhat coldish anomalies near Alaska and far eastern Russia, and then warm water in 2002, 3, 4, and 5, nothing much in 2006, and then very, very strong warming in response to the sea ice retreat. Here's an update for the last few years. This is for August. and anomalies again. And you can see the warming in 2007. 2008, there was equally strong warming, but mostly just north of Alaska due to early sea ice retreat. And then the last 3 years, it's been anomalously warm in that area near Alaska and far eastern Russia, but not as much as in the first couple of years. And in this past summer, actually, pretty strong warming north of Eurasia. By the way, here's the total, not just the anomalies. So this Reynolds data set, this satellite-derived data set, is predicting total sea surface temperatures near Alaska and far eastern Russia of, let's say, 3 to 4 degrees Celsius, though there's, as you can see, quite a lot of variability. Okay, so we used Jinlin Zhang's coupled sea ice ocean model called PIOMAS to ask some fundamental questions about this process. The first question is, why is the upper ocean warming? And we did a budget, in this case, over summer 2007. The first term is the net surface heating, so that's just everything coming down from the atmosphere into the ocean, the heating, minus any cooling that's represented by ice melt in the model grid cell. And so there it is, there in watts, megajoules per meter squared. Here's the other term, the lateral heat flux convergence. So this is the northward flowing warm water from the Pacific Ocean through Bering Strait along the coast of Alaska. And it's converging in the upper 60 meters and warming the water. So the first term is much more extensive in space, as you can see. The second term reaches actually higher amplitude, but it's much more localized near Alaska. And if you take an average over that whole area between Bering Strait and the September ice edge, then you get that 80% of the warming is local surface flux. Next question. What is the effect of this warm water on sea ice? Again, using the model, this again averaging over that, what I call the Pacific sector in the upper right there. And so here in the model is the net ice melt in that area starting in June, and you can see it's about 30 centimeters of melt on the top of flow surfaces, about the same on the bottom of the flow surfaces, and we divide it into two terms, which I won't go into today. As the summer progresses, the sun sets, the top melting goes to zero, and the bottom melting becomes more important. The ocean has absorbed the heat from the sun and is now transferring a lot of that heat to the ice. At the end, you see that in this area, there was much more bottom melting than top melting, and that compares pretty nicely with some buoy data that was in the area. So what do we have here? We have ice retreat, which is allowing the ocean to warm, which is making the ice retreat. So this is the classic ice albedo feedback. Next question. We have a warm ocean in the summertime. What happens to that heat? Can it, for instance, last through the winter somehow? Again, using the model, in this case, to confirm and expand a very nice observational paper published last year by Jennifer Jackson. So here in the model is the end of summer 2007. The water's warm, the ice has retreated like crazy. And what we're going to do is look at two spots, one under the perennial ice pack for this year and one in the open water. So that first one is under the ice, and what we see, a time series over the upper 150 meters of the ocean, we see the formation of what Jennifer termed the near surface temperature maximum, NSTM. So what's happening there at the beginning of that time series is that the water is cold at the surface, there's still ice there, but just below the surface there's solar radiation that's coming into the ocean and creating this local temperature maximum. Then in the fall, this NSTM layer descends down below the mixed layer and it survives through the winter and really into the next summer as well. On the other hand, in the open water area, it gets real hot in the summertime, but fall comes and the air is cold, ice grows, and all that heat is sucked back up to the atmosphere and none survives through the winter. What we've got going here is a competition. There's surface mixing by wind stirring and convection that's trying to get rid of all that heat in the fall. But in certain areas, in the Beaufort Gyre in particular, we have an anticyclone surface Ekman convergence and downwelling, which is pushing that NSTM layer down faster than the surface mixing can suck it back up. And so it survives. The effect on ice is shown there. So at the end of summer, there's a enough heat in this NSTM layer to melt about 1 meter of ice, or shall we say, slow the growth by 1 meter. By the end of winter, it's down to about 20 centimeters. So how shall we measure this seasonal ice zone? How should we take observations autonomously in situ? And one answer in oceanography is you put surface drifters, buoys, in the ocean. And up until a few years ago, this was how you did it in the Arctic. You went out with an icebreaker or maybe an airplane, and you look for the thickest darn piece of ice you can find, and you put a bunch of buoys in there. And that's great, but that doesn't measure the seasonal ice zone. So just a few years ago, Ignatius Rigger, the head of the International Arctic Buoy Program, I think he was the first to sort of realize that the ice is melting, we better put some buoys in the open water. So he started deploying these SVP buoys. They measure surface velocity of the ocean and sea surface temperature. So they're great, but they don't get below the surface. So how should we measure below the surface? And there's probably many answers to that question. One answer is shown here. We developed this buoy we call the UPTEMPO buoy. It stands for upper temperature of the, it used to stand for Arctic Ocean, but we just got some Antarctic funding, so polar oceans. So it's really dirt simple. It's just, actually it's an SVP buoy. It's a sphere, little more than a foot in diameter, and a string of thermistors hanging down, 12 thermistors down to 60 meters. So that spans that NSTM layer. We're sampling hourly. We're trying to keep the cost as cheap as possible so we can seed the seasonal ice zone. We're getting funding from a number of agencies. The website is there. It's still a work in progress, but you can go check it out. So here, this past summer was our real first successful nice year. We deployed a number of buoys, as shown there by the circles. And here is the view at the end of September 2011. So the color contours are that Reynolds data set, the satellite data set. It's actually not supposed to be, it's supposed to represent not just the skin temperature, but actually the temperature of some kind of mixed layer in the Arctic. And then the circles on the same color scale show you what the uppermost thermistor from the buoy was reporting. And, you know, there's some correspondence and some non-correspondence, something that needs to be looked into. Here's a picture from last week. The ice is growing and there's less water. And there are fewer buoys, unfortunately. The seasonal ice zone is a tough place to take measurements, and we're working on a number of strategies to address this. I want to tell you the story of two buoys from this past summer. The first one was deployed at the U.S. Navy Ice Camp Aplus in March of this year, near Alaska at the Red Star there, and it drifted westward towards Russia. So you can see the ice plug there. It was maybe a meter of ice. And those colors represent the thermistor depths. And so here's the time series from each of those thermistors. Actually, it was a short buoy. It only went down to 25 meters. And so you can see in spring, the ocean's still cold, and then sometime in May, warming happens. And there's some things to note. First of all, there's some indication of some warm layer that's upwelling occasionally during the springtime. But then when we get the real warming, what I really like to see is this really interesting spikes. We have diurnal warming. It gets hot and cold again on a diurnal time scale to the tune of about a degree or even more at summer solstice in the Arctic. It's really surprised me. So let's see. Here's another buoy. This was deployed about the same time, about the same position, but much later in the summer. So there was no ice there, so it was just thrown in the water off the Healy. And here's the time series from all the thermistors there. And so we again get that diurnal warming of about a degree. There's a thermocline at 10 to 15 meters depth, real shallow isothermal layer. And then down below, much colder water. So I've been asked this question, what about that 8-degree sea water? And some buoys actually got up to 10 degrees. And, you know, is that surprising? Does that freak you out or what? So is 8 degrees C SST unexpected? So what we did was we went and looked at some hydrographic data that have been collected as part of the Beaufort Gyre Exploration Project. So an icebreaker goes there every year and collects hydrographic data and does a number of other things. And so here are the average and other statistics profiles in the upper 100 meters of salinity and temperature in the ocean. For only looking where there's open water, ice concentration less than 10%. So at the surface, the ocean's very fresh, and it's also warm. The mean's about 3 degrees, and let's see, there's like plus one standard deviation is maybe 6 degrees C. So 8 degrees C, well, it's within plus two standard deviation. So, you know, is this crazy and unexpected? Sort of. I mean, it's on the high end of normal, all right? So what does the future hold? Well, I grabbed this off the web. It's a view of Antarctic sea ice. So, and that's kind of, I think, what we expect for ice in the Arctic in some ways. Large expanses of seasonally open and warming water. Waves impinging more and more on the ice pack and affecting the ice pack so that you get pancake ice, maybe rafting. But this talk was really about the ocean, so here's what I expect in the ocean, especially, let's say, in this Pacific sector, the Beaufort Gyre, the Canada Basin, near Alaska and far eastern Russia. What we're getting is a temperature and salinity profile that's looking like this. I grabbed this figure from Jennifer Jackson's paper. It shows TNS as a function of depth on a log scale, and you've got these multiple warm layers existing there because salinity controls density, not temperature, in the Arctic. So this NSTM that I described earlier, and also warm layers that are coming in from the North Pacific Ocean and the North Atlantic Ocean. And really, this is actually a simplification, because what we're finding is that this NSTM layer, there can be multiple NSTM layers, because the salinity is so variable now in the Arctic that these warm intrusive layers can form and just be at separate depths, actually. On the right, you see the salinity profile, and it's getting very stratified with very complex behavior there. So we've got a lot of warm water under the Arctic Ocean in the middle of winter, below the surface in the middle of winter, and it may be that it's getting harder and harder to get it up to the surface to melt ice because of the increasing stratification. Of course, we'll hear from meteorologists later in the session, so there may be changes in the stirring and the stress that might help to bring that up. But it's going to be a very interesting situation in the future. The temperature profile is getting very, very wiggly and very interesting. And that's all I have. Thank you.
We have time for questions. Yes.
That's a good question. I haven't really thought about it. Do you have any thoughts?
I'm wondering whether it's dealing with exports of meltwater and sea ice from the Arctic that's forming that area of the ocean. So having a semi-persistent higher pressure over the wind, which draws down the wind so that that part of the sea. But I don't know.
Yeah, I haven't really thought about it. So our paper just came out in JGR, and you can check it out. It's our model was barely good enough vertical resolution to resolve, you know, one NSTM. We were very happy about that. It actually did not resolve the next layer down, the summer Pacific water. Most ocean models have better resolution towards the surface, and then they get, you know, not as good as you go deeper. And so we actually failed to resolve a summer Pacific water temperature maximum. So I think we just barely got the NSTM, and there's no way we could have gotten multiple ones, but, you know, maybe in the next iteration of the model when we have better resolution, we could do that.
We probably should move on.
Okay.
Thanks very much, Mike. We should move on. I will ask, since we are recording this or this streaming to the web, that when questions are asked, that the speakers repeat the question so that that can be communicated. Our next speaker is Wieslaw Maslowski. Coupling ocean feedback processes in Arctic climate using ice, ocean, and fully coupled regional climate models.
Good morning. What I would like to talk about is that increasing importance of potential importance of feedbacks between the ocean and atmosphere under decreasing or diminishing sea ice cover in the Arctic. Marika and Mike have already addressed some of those issues, and I'll try to go into more details. My outline is that I'll show some preliminary results from our regional Arctic climate model, as well as standalone coupled ice-ocean simulations with prescribed realistic atmospheric forcing. I'll focus on the surface ocean atmosphere heat fluxes from those models, the importance of sea ice deformation and thickness to those processes, and then the more detailed results on the heat advection and content in the Arctic. So our regional Arctic climate model, in short RACM, is the domain is presented here. The inner domain, the shape here, is the ocean pop and sea ice model at about 9.2 kilometer resolution. The atmospheric model WRF and the land hydrology model VIC are on this larger colored domain, and they are at 50 kilometer resolution. The domains, those domains have been selected in such a way to basically include all the sea ice covered ocean in the Northern Hemisphere, the Arctic River drainage, and critical interocean exchange between the Pacific and the Arctic and the Atlantic in the Arctic, including the Labrador Sea and the Canary Archipelago. So if we look at the eastern side of the, or the Greenland side, if you look at the snapshot, monthly mean surface heat fluxes from the ocean to the atmosphere in March and September of 1993 of our spin-up model simulation, and you look at the distribution of those fluxes, the dark contour lines are representing the ice edge position, 15, 50, and 85% contour lines. And the color shading represents actually the surface heat fluxes in watts per square meter. Those numbers here along the West Spitsbergen Current and north of Svalbard, as well as along the East Greenland Current, are in the order of 3 to 350 watts per square meter in the middle of the winter. If we actually look at the different months, like in January, those fluxes can go up to over 600 watts per square meter. In the summer, the temperature difference between atmosphere and ocean is much less, so the fluxes are much lower, but still those fluxes in this area of the West Spitsbergen Current and the Barents Sea along Greenland are on the order of 30 to 50 watts per square meter. Those processes are not only the solar insulation, but actually ocean advection of warm water from the south into the Barents Sea and into the Fram Strait. And the processes associated with this ice edge and marginal ice zone are very important in representing those surface heat fluxes realistically. If we go to the Western Arctic, a very similar snapshot for March, mean March and September for the same year, 1992, from the model spin-up. Surprisingly, we have the ice cover all the way in the Arctic, including the Chukchi and the Beaufort Sea. We still get heat fluxes on the order of 30 to 50 watts per square meter from the ocean to the atmosphere in the middle of the winter when there is no other heat source to the atmosphere or to the sea ice. Another important message here is that as we're removing this heat flux from the atmosphere to the from the ocean to the atmosphere, some of this heat is actually working on the bottom of the sea ice in the middle of the winter. So that's something that I'll like to actually get in more detail in following slides. When we go into the winter, into the summer, we get heat fluxes of order of 250 watts per square meter along the Alaskan coast and over the Chukchi Plateau. And those heat fluxes are not necessarily just ice albedo effect, which I'll show also a slide on this, but also the results of advection of this solar insulation from the shelf, warmer water being advected by oceanic circulation, organized currents and mesoscale eddies into the ice edge and actually underneath the ice. If we look at the sea ice conditions in March for 1993, this is a snapshot for March 2. This is a concentration and ice drift with white vectors. We can see that there is some deformation, lower concentration of ice in the Beaufort Sea and along the Beaufort coast here and over the Chukchi Plateau, concentrations are decreasing by maybe 5 to 10%. And if we look at the divergence field, which is shown to the right, on the right upper right panel, we can clearly see that ice actually diverging here, and possibly that explains some elevated freeze melt potential here shown in the warmer color, which are associated with this divergence field. And then you can see that frozen ice production follows immediately in the same location. So this is a snapshot, and the numbers are relatively small, but if we average them over a month or a season, they might be significant. So if we look at the ice thickness changes, this is not from the Rackham model, this is from the standalone ice ocean simulation, same model domain for the ocean and ice, and we calculate the difference in ice thickness between the 20 years of 79 and 1998 and subtract the latest 6 years, 1999-2004, we can see that in the Western Arctic we have two bullseyes, one in the southeastern Beaufort Sea and one over the East Siberian Shelf. The ice reduction between the first two decades and the last 6 years, it's in excess of 1 meter. Over the East Siberian Shelf, it's in excess of 1.6 meters. So that might be enough to remove all the ice if this is supposed to be first year ice. The bottom panel actually showing that if we look at the central Beaufort Sea and we see, we try to plot a time series of the model ice drift, you can clearly see that for various months in the winter, labeled here with different colors, the ice drift in the recent years has dramatically increased, and that might be actually sufficient input to the oceanic mixing in the absence of changing or increased wind forcing. So the motion of ice in response to the thinning of the ice, increased motion of ice, might be providing still more momentum to the upper ocean to provide significant mixing to remove, to facilitate removal of heat that is accumulating with the retreating ice cover. So if we look at the Western Arctic, represented here by this Latin long line in blue, and we calculate the mean thickness for each month and remove the annual cycle from the mean thickness. This is the plot shown here by this time series in the orange and the red. You can clearly see that sometime in the 80s, we were above mean thickness for the whole region on the order of maybe half a meter or so. But starting in the mid-1990s and the late 1990s through the 2000, we have removed up down to 1.5 meter for the whole region. That's the anomaly on top of the seasonal cycle. Now, the other plots, the other time series are representing here the upper 50 meters heat content and the heat content below the 50 meters, 50 meters to 120 meters. So with the first time series, we're trying to look at the heat content within the mix layer, the surface mix layer, and the second time series with 50 to 120 meters, we're trying to understand the heat accumulation below the mix layer. So if you look at the time series of the 50 meters, every winter, fall and winter, heat is all removed from the mix layer to the atmosphere at the beginning of the melt season through the winter. However, if you look at the time series of the heat content below the mix layer, represented here by this blue line, which is a monthly 13-month running mean, we can clearly see that starting in the mid-1990s, we have accumulated and held enough heat to possibly account for this decline in the ice thickness for the whole region. There's a very strong correlation between the heat content and the ice thickness anomaly, which can explain a significant fraction of the ice thickness variance in this region. So if you look at the particular case in terms of the oceanic forcing on the sea ice, this is a 2006 Polinia shown here, and the JWACS crews, Canadian-Japanese crews during that time made a section, hydrographic section, along this yellow line. And you can clearly see that about 50 meter depth, we have water temperature of about over 0 degrees Celsius that is mixed up to the surface. And as ice is moving in a clockwise sense, it's actually melting ice along this pattern here. And if we look at the oceanic mixing that might be represented by the eddy kinetic energy with the 9 kilometer model over the Chukchi Plateau and the North Wind Ridge in particular, where this location might be actually the Polynya has been located, we don't represent much of the eddy kinetic energy that may facilitate the vertical mixing of this warmer water, summer Pacific water, upward. But if we go to the eddy resolving model at 2.4 kilometer or 148 degree, we can clearly see that there is an increased eddy activities along the Chukchi Cup, in particular along the North Wind Ridge and the Northern Chukchi Cup as well. So those eddies might be facilitating the vertical mixing upward into the mixed layer and to the bottom of the sea ice. So this is another example from the MODIS satellite for August 2007, where the green and yellowish shading is basically the solar insulation as ice has retreated further north, and the temperature in the surface are all over the western Arctic region on the order of 7 degrees Celsius. So that's not necessarily that high temperature compared to what Mike was referring. However, the sea surface temperature along the Alaskan coast, the so-called Alaskan coastal current, it's in a range of about 14 degrees Celsius. So this is your ice albedo effect. Ice has retreated, and the warmer water is sitting here behind the ice edge. Now, the oceanic currents represented here by this very organized and coastal flow and some instability as it moves into the deeper basin, eddy creation, it's on the order of twice as warm compared to the surface albedo. With a 2.4 kilometer or eddy resolving model, we can represent both the feature of the Alaskan coastal current as well as deformations that are important in representing this flow. So if we look at the total heat flux and try to understand the oceanic forcing in the pan-Arctic sense, from the Bering Strait, we have about over 10 terawatts coming into the Chukchi Sea. But by the time this heat leaves the Chukchi Shelf into the deep Beaufort Basin, we lost on the order of 70-75% of this heat advected into the southern Chukchi Shelf. So there is a solar insulation which is not accounted here. This is just advection. But the main point is that all this heat, which is entering the deep basin, is basically, most of it is about two-thirds, is going along the Alaskan coastal current, and the rest of this flow is actually very stagnant. There's no organized flow or currents. If anything, the currents actually converge toward the Point Barrow before they enter the deep basin. Very similarly, on the Barents Sea and the Nordic Sea side, more than 90% of the heat that is entering between Norway and Spitsbergen, more than 60 terawatts coming, according to our model simulation, only 6 terawatts coming out into the eastern Arctic. So all this heat is actually removed to the atmosphere and has to have effect on the atmospheric circulation if this is a 26-year mean from the model simulation. So in order to understand the effect of heat removal and heat surface heat fluxes on this side of the Arctic and this side of the Arctic, we need to have the processes in the ocean that redistribute this heat, both the coastal current, the atmospheric forcing, coastal current and the eddies that may provide heat redistribution and mixing upward to remove this heat to the atmosphere. So in summary, the air-sea interactions feedbacks under diminishing ice cover must be realistically represented in climate models in order to further improve prediction of Arctic climate change. Some of those processes that are important to those feedbacks include the ice edge and marginal ice zone processes, sea ice thickness, deformation and drift, oceanic heat convergence, coastal and boundary currents, and mesoscale eddies. And we argue that in order to obtain these improvements, we need to move into the eddy-resolving regional climate models that allow for the proper representation of the oceanic and sea ice conditions, as well as those feedbacks that probably are quite important in addressing the future of the Arctic climate change. Thank you.
We have time for questions. You were too clear. Thanks. All right. Move on to our fourth talk by June Inouye. This is Arctic Cyclogenesis at the Marginal Ice Zone, a contributory mechanism for the temperature amplification.
Can I have a pointer? My name is Jun Inoue from JAMSEC Japan, and today I will talk about the observational evidence of psychogenesis and its impact on the upper surface ocean and temperature amplification. So last year we made an Arctic cruise using Japanese research vessel Mirai, and this is the whaler animation by detected by our Doppler whaler, and we made a complete data set using this and as well as the whale sounds observations. And recently Arctic cyclones are one of hot topics for understanding the Arctic amplification, and they influence the sea ice reduction and melting, as well as the meridional and the air sea heat and moisture transport. And they are getting stronger and increasing recently. As for the social impact of cyclones, they also influence us for the northern sea route, and which have high waves with strong winds and icing on a ship or rapid sea ice recovery during late fall. So right-hand panel photo, which I took last year. So we have three anemometers on a ship, and all of them are freeze up. So we can't measure wind speed a little bit. And how to detect them? So most of studies are based on the satellites and the weather analysis due to the difficulty of observation in situ. But our study will provide a fine structure of cyclones and the cyclogenesis and its mechanisms, and the impact on the upper ocean will be investigated. So to do that, we use a Japanese research vessel, which is not an icebreaker, but ice strengthened ship, but she makes it possible to observe them with a Doppler whaler and whaler sounds by using the auto balloon launcher. And in last 2 years, we have succeeded in observing the small disturbances like a polar low. So this is the already published paper last year. So you can see that ship locates just central region of polar low. So we continued this kind of observation in last year. So we conducted special whaler sounds observation every 6 hours. And frequently, we made a 3-hourly observation. And all data are sent to GTS. That means the weather prediction and the atmospheric reanalysis accuracy should be better than usual. And the Doppler whaler, which has a set of volume scan, which consists of 21 elevations, and additional data we use sea surface meteorological data and hydrographic data and satellite data. And the reanalysis is a problem. So we already compared the three major reanalysis data set using our observational data. So the answer is the ERA interim is the best because ice concentration explicitly treated in that reanalysis. And unfortunately, Japanese one is worse. So over the thin ice area and completely ice-free ocean area, the temperature profile and turbulent heat fluxes are worst because coarse ice concentration treatment and SST, sea surface temperature treatment. Anyway, this map shows the ice concentration in shading, and the contours show the temperature at 925 hectopascal. And the date we came across the cyclone was September 23rd to 26th, and the red line shows that cruise track. And you can see that there is strong temperature gradient between sea ice and the ocean. And we also made a special section of ocean observation before and after cyclogenesis to look at how ocean quickly cooled. And this is the initial stage of cyclogenesis. So from the satellite image, by the way, the red dot shows the position of ship. So it is not clear that cyclone, but by using our radar, there was a strong rain band below the upper clouds, and the contour shows the sea level pressure. So you can see that ship locates just central region of the cyclone. And you can see also there was a pre-existing upper cyclone over the sea ice area. And by, if you look at the more closer in the radar echo in shading, and the vector shows the horizontal winds detected by Doppler velocity. So you can see that there was a deformation field, which is a typical feature for the frontogenesis. And the right-hand panel shows the extratropical cyclone case observed by airborne radar over the Gulf Stream. So the system is very similar to ours. Anyway, after passing the cold front, the system explosively developed and moved to southeastward. And again, you can see that the ship position locates just central region of the cyclone. And if you look at the cloud and the thermal structures, you can see that at the initial stage, baroclinic leaf cloud here, and frontal fracture can be seen here, and bent back warm front and the T-bone structure of clouds, and at the mature stage, the warm seclusion can be found. So all these features are very similar to the Shapiro-Kaiser's frontal cyclone life cycle. That means that meridional heat transport can be occur even in high latitude under the diminishing sea ice situation. And the mechanisms of explosive development of cyclone is coupling process between upper and lower potential vorticity. So left-hand panel shows the time height cross-section. So time axis from right to left. And shading is the radar reflectivity just above the ship. And the contours shows the air temperature observed by radio sounds. And the black contour shows the sea level pressure we observed. So there was two minimum SLP. So one is the initial surface cyclogenesis. And the second one is the upper potential vorticity intrusion, which usually has the cold dome at the from mid troposphere to lower troposphere. And at that time, we observed a very clear tropopause fault in temperature profiles. And the right panel shows the trajectories of upper PV and the lower PV. So as pink is the upper potential vorticity, so as upper PV approaches the marginal ice zone, the lower PV in black line followed it and is enhanced. So we can say that rapid cyclogenesis is associated with the coupling process between upper and the lower PVs. And at the mature stage of cyclogenesis and the development, cold air coming in from sea ice area behind the cold front. So our Doppler radar detected a very beautiful cloud street, which has a stratocumulus cloud. So this means that a large amount of heat flux is coming from ocean to the atmosphere. So this is the sea ice concentration and sea surface temperature detected by AMSUR-E sensor and before the cyclogenesis. And after cyclogenesis, the ice age advanced and sea ice recovery proceeds, and the sea surface temperature also decreased about 2 Kelvin. And at that time, we have a special oceanic section before and after the cyclogenesis. So I show the results. So left and the middle panel shows the latitudinal depth cross-section of water temperature in shading and the salinity in contour. And the right panel shows the their difference. So you can see that about 1.5 Kelvin decrease up to 20 meter depth. So the heat released, heat amount which released to the atmosphere was 123 megajoule per square meter. So this heat can be warmed and yeah. So if this kind of phenomena frequently occur, the Arctic amplification during late fall and winter will be proceed, I think. And to summarize, Arctic cyclone was observed directly over the ice-free ocean. And the mechanism, thermal contrast is very important for the initial stage. And for the explosive development, upper PB intrusion is very important. And the Arctic cyclone has a similar life cycle to a mid-latitude one, and this suggests a northward shift of meridional heat transport. And air-sea heat transfer induced by this kind of cyclones might be essential for the Arctic amplification if this kind of event frequently occur. And our Doppler radar and the radar sonde auto-launcher system are vital to detect this kind of system. So I can say Japanese research vessel, although this is not an icebreaker, has a principal role to open up them under diminishing sea ice situation. And in 2014, we have a special observation using this ship, especially in the atmospheric observation. So if you're interested in joining and collaborate your ship or airplanes and buoys, please let me know in advance. Thank you.
Other questions? I think that might get an award for miserable working conditions. Yes.
We don't know. So previous storm.
Could you repeat the question?
I think I understand
okay.
There, but
go ahead,
yeah, yeah. So we don't know the previous storms where that cyclones formed, but in the mid-latitude cyclone also very important for the. Intrusion of upper potential vorticity. So I think it's very common feature of the cyclogenesis.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
I'm Kathy Wilson from Los Alamos National Lab. Our next speaker is Vladimir Alexeev.
So I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share my results with you. And my talk will be about processes forming the polar amplification in the high latitudes. And shown here is one of those future climate projections, and we can see that the climate response at high latitudes is higher than over almost the rest of the globe. So I would like to acknowledge the contributions from these individuals, Peter Langen, who used to be a PhD student of mine, Craig Jackson, Igor Izao, and Judah Cohen. Okay, so my bottom line message from part one is that atmospheric heat transport is important for polar amplification in systems without any ice albedo feedbacks. So, and shown here is our article that we published in Climate Dynamics in 2005. We ran two models, CCSM and GEOS, without any annual cycle, without any sea ice or snow, no continents, with and without clouds, and in all cases we were able to obtain a nice pattern, polar amplified pattern in a global warming-like experiment. So the mechanism for that is the following. So we have our climate system. This is a Hadley cell. This is outgoing long wave. And the important part of our climate system is the poleward heat transport of warm and moist air from the tropics. So this warm and moist air has important implications for the surface budget. Because it's warm and moist, it blocks the long wave, and it also warms the air. And the manifestation of this effect is basically inversions in the high Arctic. So what happens when we suddenly increase the amount of greenhouse gas, double CO2? What happens is the following. We emit less long wave, and because the greenhouse forcing is almost uniform, we can expect that the surface will start warming almost uniformly as well. So as a result of that, we will see more injection of heat from the surface in the tropics. And this effect, the increase in these fluxes is higher than the top of the atmosphere can emit, so therefore all this heat has to go polewards. And as a result, the poleward heat transport accelerates in the atmosphere, with, again, very important implications for the surface budget. The surface in the Arctic will start warming up faster. So this is what we discussed in all those articles. That was a very interesting academic exercise, polar amplification in a system without any ice albedo feedbacks. So there were some other articles that discussed very similar mechanism, and the earliest one is probably an article by Brian Flannery, where he included the transport of latent heat, and by inclusion of this latent heat, he was able to obtain polar amplification in an EBM, energy balance model. And the key word here is latent. Latent is what's responsible for the whole thing. So, and then there was a paper by Ed Schneider where he looked at a response to a very localized anomaly in the tropics, and he found a very global and almost uniform response. Gerrit Lohmann published a few articles with collaborators, and I'm showing here just one of them where he suggested a very similar mechanism for northern hemisphere deglaciation. Okay, so what happens when we introduce ice albedo feedback? This is I am discussing in this part of the talk. So to do that, I am going back to my idealized world. This is my climate system. It consists of two boxes, but now I'm forming sea ice. So this is incoming solar, outgoing long wave, the poleward heat transport, and I'm assuming that the temperature in the tropics is uniform, and it's falling off linearly from the tropical temperature all the way down to the poles in the extratropical box. The place where I'm crossing the freezing line is the ice margin. So now I have my ice albedo in the system, and I will try to estimate relative importance of ice albedo against the poleward heat transport feedback. And this is just a mixed layer ocean. Okay, so, and I think this is the simplest setup you can come up with. So I do like equations, and those are my equations. So this is a usual energy balance model. It has a polar heat transport, and this is Boudica Sellers like outgoing long wave. And I do emit more short wave when I have ice area. And the important thing in the polar heat transport is that I am including now the effect of latent and sensible, which depends on the equator to pole temperature gradient and the coefficient which mimics the latent depends on the temperature in the tropics. So the more, the warmer the climate is, the more water vapor we will have in our system. Yeah, and here's the paradox. So in a global GCM, you cannot fix polar heat transport, but here I can. And maybe this model is more useful than a global GCM for qualitatively assessing ice albedo feedback. So even in this simple model, analyzing feedbacks is not so simple. So this is our summer, this summers, our summer school project, and those are bright individuals that worked on this project. And Craig Jackson actually used a piece of software to analyze all the dependencies, and you can see it's difficult actually to understand what depends on what. So again, I think this model is more useful than a GCM to analyze the atmospheric heat transport feedback. Okay, so here's my plan for the rest of the talk. First of all, I will create a set of climates, and I will test sensitivity of my model with all feedbacks operating in each of the climates. Then I will fix albedo and atmospheric heat transport feedbacks. Then I will do feedback analysis on the global temperature and on temperatures in the two boxes separately. So here's my range of climates. So I'm imposing a forcing at the top of the atmosphere, solar-like forcing, and I go from ice age to a very warm climate with no sea ice. So at each point, as I said, I will perturb my system by a global warming-like forcing, and we'll see how the model will respond with various feedbacks operating. So now the axes are different. Here's my range of climates. This is the ice age, and this is a hothouse. So the ice margin disappears when we hit 20 C for the global temperature. And I'm calculating here the polar amplification, which I define as a ratio between changes in the temperatures in the extratropical box and the tropical box. So you can see that I do get significant polar amplification when I have no sea ice. And the amplification is much weaker when the climate gets colder. So, and there's an interesting maximum here, which is actually close to the present-day climate, when we have a maximum of sensitivity of polar amplification. And we'll get to that later. So what happens when I fix the feedbacks? First of all, I will fix the albedo feedback. And we still get significant polar amplification. Obviously, it's the same when I have no sea ice because I have no sea ice albedo feedback. And it monotonically falls off down to no amplification as climate gets colder because I will not have too much water in the system. And the presence of water in the system is the mechanism that explains polar amplification when I have no ice feedback. So when I turn off the atmospheric heat transport feedback, obviously I will have no amplification when I will have no ice. And there's an interesting maximum, again, somewhere around present-day climate when we get maximum polar amplification. Then again, the polar amplification gets weaker. Okay, so it's actually easy to understand that there's no polar amplification with no ice albedo feedback and atmospheric heat transport turned off. It's clear that we will always get some amplification if we have some sea ice. As the planet gets colder, the amplification will go down. So there should be a maximum in between. So, but in my world, interestingly, it's around present-day climate. So probably in the present-day climate, ice albedo feedback is the most important feedback in the Arctic. And as a matter of fact, we do have an article about it that we published in Climatic Change, where we argue that the surface processes are probably most important in shaping the recent processes in the Arctic. And there's a bunch of articles by Jim Overland, Mark Serres, and other people who argue that surface is probably most important in the presently observed changes. So what happens to the atmospheric heat transport? When I do not have albedo feedback, the atmospheric heat transport changes in a doubling CO2 experiment. Basically, the atmospheric heat transport always increases. But with the inclusion of the albedo feedback, the behavior of the change in atmospheric heat transport becomes very nonlinear. So what happens here is the following. So when we do have ice albedo feedback, the high latitudes warm up so fast so that the increase in the latent does not compensate the decrease in the sensible. So this is the basic mechanism for no effect of atmospheric heat transport somewhere in the middle when we have no water vapor feedback and when we have only water vapor feedback operating. Another important message from this plot is that maybe ice albedo feedback is more important in colder climates, including maybe present-day climates, but then it will obviously become much less important, and then the atmospheric heat transport will become the dominant mechanism for polar amplification. So when sea ice starts disappearing, probably the atmosphere will play a more important role in the polar amplification. That's my message. Okay, and when you do a formal feedback analysis, you can see that the ice albedo feedback, when you do feedback analysis on the global temperature, you see that ice albedo feedback is always dominating. And I want you to be impressed how unimportant the atmospheric heat transport looks using this formal feedback analysis. So we do have to do this feedback analysis on the two temperatures. And this is my feedback analysis on the two temperatures. You can see that the atmospheric heat transport becomes more important as ice starts disappearing, and it's the only mechanism that is operating and responsible for polar amplification when we have no sea ice. It destabilizes the higher latitudes and it stabilizes the lower latitudes. Okay, and this is just a brief announcement about our poster that we have this afternoon. So please come and see us at the poster. This is a poster about cooling in Siberia as a part of the global warming picture. So warm Arctic, cold continents. And those are my conclusions. So it seems that the albedo feedback is more important in cold climates, while atmospheric heat transport mechanism will become more important as ice disappears. Probably recent changes in the high Arctic seem to have been driven primarily by the surface processes. I have not discussed this point, but the presence of the atmospheric heat transport mechanisms will influence timescales in the system. And this is a general statement, even if the atmospheric heat transport does not change in a warmer world, its composition will change. We will have more latent going polewards with potential implications for the freshwater cycle, clouds, and radiation at the high latitudes. Thank you.
We'll entertain one short question.
Okay.
The question was about the importance of ocean heat content in this analysis. Well, I am not looking at ocean heat transport mechanisms, but the ocean heat transport is important, and the presence of Atlantic and Pacific water is one of the two crucial processes that influence the thinning of sea ice. So I do not have an answer yet because I don't have a box for the ocean here. But I do recognize the importance of these processes.
Thank you for having me. Our next speaker is Bob Bolton from University of Alaska.
Good morning. Thank you for coming. Before I begin, I'd like to acknowledge my co-author, Larry Hensman. Okay. Co-author Larry Hensman, we're both at the International Arctic Research Center located on the campus of the University of Alaska Fairbanks. Today I'm going to present an overview, some conceptualizations of some unique problems and some modeling needs that need to be addressed in order to quantify and understand the feedbacks and interactions of thermal karst and hydrologic processes. This one. So the northern environment is warming. The climate is changing. There has been observed increases in air temperature, and those increases are expected to continue to rise. There have been changes in the patterns of precipitation, and also it's been well documented that permafrost is also warming in northern environments. Associated with this, there have been a number of studies that have documented changes in the hydrologic regime that have been attributed to this change in climate and permafrost regime. Examples of this include draining of ponds, increased base flows of large northern rivers, changes in snow accumulation and snow melt, etc. As highlighted last week's Nature Journal, the amount of organic carbon stored in these northern soils is much greater than previously estimated. This article also also highlighted that the amount, the rate, and form of carbon release from these soils is unknown, but is tied to permafrost thaw. Permafrost thaw is also and subsidence is also tightly coupled to soil moisture and temperature. And so, in order to understand the mechanisms and the release and the form and rates in which carbons can be released from these soils, it is critical that we understand the interactions and feedbacks associated with permafrost thaw and hydrology. Permafrost is defined, or thermokarst is defined, as the thawing of ice-rich soils, which results in a creation of this depression in the ground surface. There are many different types of thermokarst terrain. 22 have been identified by Tor Jorgensen. They include thermokarst ponds, bogs and thermokarst bogs, pingo collapse, beaded streams, etc. The types of thermokarst terrain are dependent upon climate, topography, soil texture, the hydrologic condition, and ground ice. Ground ice is probably the most important factor in determining the form of the thermokarst terrain. And then finally, permafrost degradation can be experienced from either the surface due to thermokarst expansion from the sides, due to lateral heat flow internally from groundwater intrusion, or from the bottom with groundwater heat flux. This figure on the right is from a study by Joel Rowland and others at Los Alamos National Lab showing the influence of lateral heat flux has on degrading permafrost. This can be significant. In understanding and thinking about these northern systems in both field studies and modeling development, I believe it's critical that each of these components need to be thought of as a whole system, not as individual components. For example, you can't understand the permafrost regime without understanding the ecosystem, the hydrology, or the climate system. And similarly, you can't understand the hydrology without considering the permafrost or the ecosystem or the climate system. So when I talk about a changing hydrologic regime, I'm also implying that there are concurrent changes in the ecosystem, permafrost, and climate at the same time. Here's a conceptual diagram of the important processes, energy, water, thermokarst processes that need to be considered when designing a landscape evolution or a thermokarst model in terms of hydrology and permafrost. It's also important when designing field studies to incorporate and think about these processes in order to formulate and develop the models. So we've identified three different mechanisms subsidence and deformation has on subsidence of surface topography has on hydrologic processes and regimes. Changes in vegetation, increased connectivity and changes in lateral flow, channel flow, and changes in the energy regimes. And I'll spend a few minutes talking about each of these three processes. First, I'll start with a change in energy regime. The change in energy regime is dependent upon the thermokarst form as well as the state of degradation. In this example, thermokarst near Council, Alaska on the Seward Peninsula, we see a change in albedo. We see a change in from a sensible heat-dominated ecosystem to a more latent heat system. However, on these sides, where drainage is enhanced, sensible heat flux is probably greater than it was prior to thermokarst or the subsidence of the ground. It's also important to note that the thermal regime has also changed significantly with the pooling of water in this lowland, also enhancing permafrost degradation. This lower left image shows a high center polygon on the Lena Delta, Lena River Delta in Siberia. High center polygon here, and this is in September after an early snowfall event. What I want to show here is that the energy regime changes as snow accumulates in these low troughs, and snow is a great insulating property, and so the summer heat that was stored, the ground heat that's stored over the summertime is being released more quickly in this high-centered area as opposed to these troughs, effectively warming these lower areas. And finally, here's the thermokarst pond near Fairbanks, Alaska in the deciduous forest, or coniferous forest, boreal forest. Again, I want to show going from a sensible heat flux energy environment to a more latent heat flux, and also I want to just take note that the thermal regime of this near surface is dramatically changed with this thermokarst development. Changes in vegetation is the next thing I would like to talk about. As permafrost degrades, there's an opportunity for new vegetation to establish itself. In terms of hydrologic responses, a change in vegetation will mean a change in response in terms of whether it's an evaporation or a transpiration-dominated ecosystem. Changes in soil moisture will also occur if you have deeper roots. The hydrologic response to a precipitation event will also change. In terms of energy, you can have changes in vegetation may lead to changes in snow cover, which leads in changes of albedo. The vegetation change may also influence the albedo effects as well. And the ground thermal regime is also changed with vegetation. In shrub, tussock shrub chandra is shown here. These shrubs tend to trap snow, influencing the hydrologic regime as well as the energy regimes. In the boreal forest, where I come from, a degrading permafrost can lead to a shift in ecosystem type, going from a coniferous dominated ecosystem to a more deciduous dominated ecosystem. And the responses, hydrologic responses and the energy responses to these two different ecosystems is dramatic. Huge differences in evaporation, in transpiration, soil moisture dynamics, and stream flow response. The last point I would like to talk about is changes in drainage patterns. Permafrost degradation tends to pool or store water in low-lying areas and to enhance flow in upland areas or in areas with a bit of topography, and I'll show a couple examples, an example of each one of these things. Here on the bottom I'm showing ice wedge polygons from Barrow, Alaska, near Barrow, Alaska. The left image is a high center polygon, and the left and the right is a low center polygon. And I have comparisons of each to demonstrate. So these areas here here and here are the high center polygons, and the troughs are shown below here. And then on this right-hand image, you can see that the low center polygons are represented here with the rims following around. And you can also make out the ice wedge network in between these low center polygons. I want to emphasize that although it looks like there's a fair amount of topography, this area is incredibly flat. Spatial resolution on this is 40 meters and on this about 70 meters, and the difference between the high and low points is 55 centimeters and 75 centimeters here, so it's incredibly flat. The lines on this plot represent flow paths as generated from an automated algorithm that determines stream flow routing. In this animation, I'm showing the same two DEMs being pulsed with precipitation for 6 hours, then drying out for 6 hours. Dark colors represent areas of no flow or low flow, and blues and reds represent areas of flow going from higher flow to lower flow areas. And so if we look at the high center polygon, high center polygon, immediately following the precipitation event, you see a draining of the of water to the trough area down here below, but then the trough areas tend to stay very wet, as we'd expect, and see here very, very slow drainage. In this low center polygon following precipitation event, we see that water immediately drains away from the polygon edges, the rims, towards the center and pools up, and then slowly drains out through the bottom of this, in this example. Very different, very close in proximity to each other, but very different stream flow responses, and these need to be accounted for when thinking about designing a numerical model. Anna Lilly et al. has recently done some work which shows the importance of this, where she's simulating high center polygons and comparing low center polygons. High center polygons are the pink lines here, and she has shown that the cumulative runoff is much higher, significantly higher than low center polygons. The evaporation is lower, and the water table is lower. And so it's important to consider the types of polygons and be able to evolve when the landscape is evolving, be able to evolve these your model needs to be able to evolve to account for these different types of polygons as they change through time. The next example, the final example, is looking at surface deformation and enhancement of flow on a sloped ground. And this is a disturbance that's near Fairbanks. This was caused by a disturbance in the surface energy balance caused by the placement of a trail, a four-wheeler trail that was overused on an ice wedge. The result of this was initial ponding of water. These small ponds, pits of water eventually connected and eventually formed this big, massive gully that this thermal erosion feature. The ponds took some time to develop and connect, but once they connected, the erosion process was very quick. This pit or gully is more than 2 meters deep and formed in less than 5 years' time. So it's very rapid in this process. This gully is still being formed now, still in motion. And in order to show the enhancement of flow with topography, I show three different images. Here is a top view, a side view of surface topography, and then the flow paths, as I showed in the previous slide. It's a 100 by 100 meter. It's a gentle slope. The top is 1 meter higher than the lower box. In this example and demonstration, I artificially create three thermal karst depressions, and at each time step, I increase the laterally and horizontally the thermal karst deformation, the pits. And once the pits intersect with each other, then I allow routing of water out through a thermal erosion and gully process, and we can watch how these processes, how the enhancement of the water flows. And so here I'm just So the three pits are here, the channels open up, and then the flow is enhanced. I don't think it's a big stretch to show the process that's going on here or here is similar to this one here, creation of ponds that intersect with each other, form a big erosion gully, and transport sediment out. When thinking about, I'll wrap up here, in thinking in terms of local and regional scales, there are a number of questions from a field observation perspective as well as modeling perspective that needs to be addressed by the scientific community. The first is what initiates the thermokarst process. We know that land surface or surface energy balance disturbance, either through wildfire or roads, can influence the initiate the thermokarst process. But at the same time, there are a lot of random thermokarsting features, or apparently random thermokarst features that are occurring, and we need to know why. What determines the rate of change, vertical and horizontal propagation? And to that same end, how does when does this degradation end? An important question. And how does it stabilize? And the final point is that what is the ice content and what form does ice take? And I believe this is the most important question that we need to resolve over large regional spatial scales. Thank you.
We'll take one question. Okay, I think we'll go ahead and move on. Thank you, Bob. Our next speaker is Susan Hubbard from Lawrence Berkeley National Lab.
Thanks, Kathy. Let me switch this. This is the PC one, right? Right. Great. Okay, I'm very happy to have an opportunity to tell you about the Next Generation Ecosystem Experiment, or NG Arctic. This is a new Department of Energy 10-year project, which is just being initiated, and I am speaking on behalf of a team of about 50. Here are shown the project leads, and Stan Welshinger is the PI of the project, and Larry Hintzman from University of Alaska Fairbanks is our chief scientist. This project is really focused on developing a predictive understanding of terrestrial ecosystem feedbacks to climate. And we've chosen to poise our study in the Arctic because, as we've heard and we know, Arctic processes will be significant drivers to ecosystem climate feedbacks at the local scale. And also because these are vulnerable landscapes that are in transition with abundant permafrost, ground ice, and soil organic carbon that really complicates prediction of these ecosystem feedbacks to climate. And so we recognize that in order to, that it's very necessary to understand the mechanisms that control the carbon and energy transfer in the biosphere, not only under current conditions, but in the future as these landscapes evolve with warming. So what we're showing here is just a figure of these landscape evolutions that are accelerated by warming or permafrost thaw. We have here two very common geomorphic units in the Arctic landscape. On the upper right, we see thaw lakes and some remnants of thaw lakes after they've drained. These can drain by a variety of mechanisms, and they can do so very quickly, sometimes on the order of hours to days. In the bottom left, what we see are these polygonal ground and transitions from low-centered polygons, more healthy permafrost, to high-centered polygons, where permafrost is more degrading. And what's important about these common landscape features in the Arctic is that they have the potential to really change the water distribution, both vertically and laterally, as we heard in the last presentation. And that, in turn, that change in water distribution has a real potential to change vegetation dynamics above ground and also to change the potential of the microbial biology in the below ground to degrade that organic-rich carbon and produce greenhouse gases. The problem is that these coupled hydrological, geological, biological processes that control these feedbacks are not well understood, nor are they well represented in models. So the NG science question, keeping in mind this is a 10-year project, is poised on trying to quantify how permafrost thaw and degradation influences that landscape evolution, how that in turn influences water distribution, the above-ground biology, the below-ground biology, and feedbacks to climate. And our real goal is development of a process-rich ecosystem model that extends from the bedrock to the top of the canopy, where the evolution of the Arctic ecosystem in this changing climate can be modeled at the scale of a high-resolution Earth system grid model, so say on the order of 30 kilometers by 30 kilometers. So this is a large challenge, and why is it so complicated? What we're going to look at here is Arctic landscape at a close view and then stepping up to the scale where we want to be able to predict this and feed this into the climate models at 30 kilometer by 30 kilometer grid. And at the smaller scale, here we're looking at the order of 1 to 10 kilometer length scales. We're looking at polygonal ground. And by the way, each of these boxes here fits into the box on the next slide or the next image. And what we see is the polygonal ground that's influenced, well, water and snow distribution, like we saw in the last presentation, vegetation. And what we can't see, but we can infer, is that these variations in water have also impacted redox distributions in the subsurface, which influence the ability of those microbes to degrade that organic carbon. And so what we expect then is spatially variable at the local scale, albedo, as well as greenhouse gas fluxes. As we move up in scale, and again now we're moving these boxes into further and further, we're stepping away from the land surface, we're looking at, I guess, what we would call the landscape scale. And we see that that polygonal ground is really in the background of that land surface matrix, and what's in the foreground are these thaw lakes. Again, we expect that these lakes are going to contribute very significantly to albedo, to carbon cycling. And then finally, we move up to the scale where we really want to interface with the climate models. And we see that we're in Barrow, Alaska, and we see a mosaic of land surface features, drainage networks, and the thaw lakes, and the polygonal ground. And so when we look at the Arctic system in this way, we recognize how difficult, if not impossible, it would be to really just study these processes at this very local scale and linearly feed these up into that some sort of upscaling mechanism and represent those at that larger grid. Instead, what we recognize is that we really do have to understand what processes are controlling energy and carbon balances at the native scales where those processes are occurring. And we also have to recognize that there are likely to be feedbacks, nonlinearity, and really complex behavior. So it's a complex, it's a hierarchical system. And so NG has developed a research scope recognizing these characteristics of the system. What I'm showing here is the NG research framework. As I said, we're very interested in scale integration across those scales where these processes are happening, and we're very interested in process integration. And by process integration, we're interested in understanding the key controls of the three components of the Arctic system, the hydrogeomorphology, the soil biogeochemistry, the plant dynamics, and the integration between all of those. How do we go about this? NG is really a model-driven enterprise. We're interested in developing a predictive understanding of this system, and how we do it is with very tight integration between simulations, observations, and experiments that extend really from the molecular scale all the way up to the landscape scale. And so what I'd like to do now, and in the rest of the talk, just to give you a flavor about some of the NG research portfolio, is step through some tasks associated with scale integration as well as process integration. Keeping in mind that the process integration, we've really prioritized processes that we think are necessary to reduce that model uncertainty and ecosystem climate feedbacks. Okay, so starting with a scale integration, we've developed a plan for a hierarchical NG simulation framework, and actually we'll be asking the community for feedback on this early next year. And what we envision that we need to be able to develop a predictive understanding of these ecosystem feedbacks to climate is at least three scales of models, where at the largest scale we have a 3D process resolving models that can deal with ice wedge dynamics, the role of thermal karst in the reorganization of mass and energy,
energy fluxes. At the next scale up, we need a 2D, maybe a 3D model that can resolve hydrological connectivity and the changes in that connectivity as that land surface evolves. And then finally, at the next scale up, we need a model that can represent these Arctic tundra processes in climate scale and climate change predictions. Now, we're not just talking about a hierarchical model where we have small-scale processes feeding up. We really have feedback between both upscaling and downscale. And what we envision over reasonable time steps are cross-scale iterative solutions that we think are very necessary to honor energy mass and momentum conservation. And what we also envision is that the transfer of this information up and down scale will be organized around these geomorphic units, such as the thaw lakes, such as the polygonal ground that we've already discussed. Okay, so this is the framework for integrating our data, for testing our hypothesis, for feeding this information up so we can look at ecosystem feedbacks to climate. And what I'd like to do now is step through some of the process-based understanding that we're planning on doing in these three system components, again, keeping in mind that we're looking at processes that are high priority for reducing model uncertainty. And the first challenge is called hydrogeomorphology, and as we've already talked about earlier in this presentation and in the last presentation, as these landscapes evolve, great potential to change water and heat distribution. And so this challenge is really focused on trying to understand the controls of those thermokarst and what that means as far as heat and water distribution. And what I'll do for each of these challenges is show you an example task or two. And a real key component of the hydrogeomorphology challenge is developing, validating, parameterizing a thermohydrogeological mechanical model that can simulate the evolution of this landscape and the associated water and heat distribution. And in fact, in the last presentation, we've already seen a few of these images here. There are models out there that are looking at some components of that system, but we absolutely do not have right now a high-resolution landscape simulator that can capture those processes now and as that land system evolves with warming. Another key component is how do we bring together a variety of different data sets, subsurface point data, subsurface geophysics, remote sensing data, to be able to cleverly parameterize and validate this model and understand how subsurface variability in properties reflects land surface variability, particularly microtopography. The next key component of the system that we're going to talk about is the soil biogeochemistry challenge. And this is also an extremely important component of the system. We know that there's a lot of organic carbon locked up in these frozen soils. And the real concern and a large source of uncertainty is what's going to happen with warming as this active layer where the microbes are degrading this organic expands and we get the production of greenhouse gases. And these mechanisms associated with organic matter decomposition are really thought to be critical and could be big enough that they transition these ecosystems from what's been traditionally a greenhouse gas sink to a greenhouse gas source. So again, the models, the mechanisms and the rates controlling this organic matter decomposition in and around these Arctic landscape features now and as they evolve are not well understood or represented in models, and that's the focus of this challenge. Again, we've identified a variety of objectives that we think are high priorities for reducing model uncertainties. And what I highlight here is just one task, which is really focused on trying to improve our understanding of temperature controls on greenhouse gas fluxes by doing coupled laboratory field measurements and simulations to incorporate revised temperature respiration response functions into models to reduce uncertainty. And here we're looking at a study by Bill Riley, simulation study that recognizes the sensitivity of methane emissions as a function of Q10, this respiration parameter, where most of the work's been done near room temperature, and we know our Arctic soils are order of magnitude less than that. And so a lot of work needed here. Okay, finally, this last system component is the plant dynamics challenge. And we've said that these landscapes are going to thaw, and that'll change not only moisture availability, but nitrogen availability. That, in turn, has a huge potential to change both the structure and the function of these tundra plant communities and to feed back to climate in ways that we don't understand right now. And so we, again, have developed a suite of objectives. Each of these has many tasks. Here I focus on one particular
particular task, which is improved representation of Arctic plant functional types within models. And so we have a variety of tasks in the laboratory, in the field, developing improved representations of plant functional types that particularly consider nitrogen and water acquisition strategies, and then using those in dynamic vegetation models to understand if we can simulate that pattern distribution of plants, what it means in terms of feedbacks to climate now and as that land surface evolves. Okay, so we've talked about the development of a hierarchical simulator. We've talked about process understanding in each of those three key system components. And of course, what we're really interested in doing is bringing that all together to address the NG questions that we've already poised earlier. How does permafrost thaw have these cascade of processes that ultimately really influence ecosystem feedbacks to climate? This is a big challenge to be able to do this. This is something that we think we won't be able to tackle till we're several years down the road and we have better process understanding under our belts, better simulators to be able to do that. But when we are ready, we'll be, I think, well poised to address some really important questions. Will CO2 released from soil organic carbon decomposition be greater than the CO2 that's taken up by plants? How will changes in geomorphology affect the trajectory of methane emissions over time? What processes govern the rate at which Arctic albedo changes, as we've been talking about today? So a lot of important things that need to be done that need both process understanding and simulation capabilities. So I'd like to wrap up by saying a little bit about why DOE, Department of Energy, for those of you who are not familiar with it, has a real mission focused around energy and in the environment. So this falls squarely within Department of Energy mission. Above that, though, DOE scientists are really well suited to carry out model-driven enterprises that take advantage of our high-performance computing capabilities and also to develop and maintain long-term research facilities and long-term databases such as we propose to do here. Additionally, we have a lot of expertise across the national labs and with our partner institutions. We can and we have for this team brought together a real multidisciplinary group of experts where we have a lot of the basically the expertise to tackle these really tough questions that involve a lot of different aspects of science. And I'd like to wrap up by saying that we hope that NG, as we get going, will really serve as a community resource. We will have well-instrumented and characterized field sites, and we very much welcome the community to join us working at these field sites, as well as to ask for samples, for example. We will have extensive databases and ideally community codes that can be used by others to just advance Arctic science in general. And we will be hosting a variety of workshops, both to get feedback on our plans, but to really solidify collaboration possibilities now and in the future. So I'd like to thank you for your time and mention that there'll be a whole town hall meeting on this tomorrow, and so there's an hour dedicated to delving in and talking a little bit deeper about what motivates NG and some of the modeling efforts and some of the process-driven science. So we welcome you to join us, and we also keep our project website pretty up to date. So thank you very much.
We'll entertain one question for Susan.
All right, thank you.
Okay, well, moving on. Thank you. Our last speaker is Jennifer Francis, and she will talk to us. We'll expand out from the land surface now and look at how Arctic amplification may fuel extreme weather in mid-latitudes.
The buttons. Okay. Well, thank you all for hanging in here. I know everybody's ready for lunch, and I want to thank Jim and the program organizers for inviting me to be here today. And I also want to thank my collaborator, Steve Vavris, for some really fun conversations about the work that I'm going to tell you about today, which is all brand new. So I want to start by taking you back to the good old days in the Arctic, when we could look down from our satellites onto an Arctic Ocean at the end of summer filled with lots of healthy, thick sea ice. But as we all know, things don't look much like that anymore, and we're into this new era of a much diminished sea ice cover that looks more like that. And in fact, the difference between these two sea ice covers at the end of the summer is approximately 850,000 square miles. And that's equal to about the area of Alaska and Texas combined. And for the Europeans in the group, that's about the same as the size of Spain and Germany combined. So I think the question now becomes not whether sea ice loss is affecting large-scale atmospheric circulation, it's how can it not be? And what are the mechanisms that are driving it? Well, this is not something that I've thought of all by myself. There's been a whole bunch of studies lately. This is just a few of them in the last few years. Most of these have looked at how the sea ice loss is affecting the atmosphere in kind of a general way. And what I want to do today, though, is focus right in on how the Arctic amplification, which we know means the enhanced warming in the Arctic relative to mid-latitudes, is perhaps affecting extreme weather in mid-latitudes. And I want to be very clear about what I mean by extreme weather. What I'm talking about are high amplitude, very slow moving patterns in the upper level atmosphere that tend to cause very persistent weather conditions at the surface. So the sorts of extreme weather that might be associated with that would be like droughts and heat waves, things that depend on the weather conditions persisting for a long time. So for example, we can look at the 500 millibar anomaly patterns for the coldest days in Tampa. And you can see that the anomaly pattern looks like a very high amplitude 500 millibar pattern. The same for the hottest days in Atlanta, a very high amplitude 500 millibar pattern, and once again for the wettest days in Chicago. So these are the sorts of extreme weather events that I'm talking about. So let's think back again to the sea ice. And Mike and Wieslaw did a wonderful job this morning of explaining how, because we've lost all the sea ice by the end of the summer, all this extra heat has been absorbed by the ocean, and when the freeze-up starts again in the fall, most of that heat then gets released to the atmosphere in the form of sensible and latent heat. And it's very clear, you can see that in the anomalies of the near-surface temperature, and for example, from 2000 to 2010, the anomalies are up around 5-6 degrees. I mean, they're really quite astounding. And as that boundary layer warms, the warming continues up into the upper troposphere, and it actually affects also the thickness or the difference in height between the 1,000 millibar surface and the 500 millibar surface. We've stepped back in this figure, so you're looking at a much bigger area. You can see the thickness anomalies for the same decade are much larger in extent. So if you increase the thicknesses more in high latitudes versus mid-latitudes, then you'd expect to find a weaker poleward thickness gradient, and we know that thickness gradient is what drives the zonal winds. So first let's look at how that thickness gradient has changed over the last, well, half of a century almost. And we've got them for each season. And if you look at the brown line there, which is for the autumn season, you can see that since about the mid-80s, it's decreased dramatically. This is the thickness gradient between mid-latitudes and high latitudes between North America and the North Atlantic. And you could do this pretty much anywhere, but I'm going to focus in on the North America, North Atlantic region for most of this analysis that I'm going to show you today. Now, the other interesting thing there is you can see that the winter curve is also decreasing dramatically. If we look at the thickness anomalies for wintertime, they look a lot different, but there's still a great big thickness anomaly centered right over the North Atlantic. So as I said, if you decrease these, the poleward thickness gradient, you should expect to see a decrease in the zonal flow, because that's what drives the zonal flow. And in fact, if you look at the time series of the zonal flow in this region, you see almost 20% decrease in the zonal mean winds at 500 millibars in both fall and winter. And I should mention that all the data that I'm going to be showing you today are from the NSEP reanalysis. Okay, so we want to dig a little deeper into this. I'm going to focus mostly on the fall and winter because that's where the sea ice is coming into play. But there's also an interesting thing going on in the summer. If I have time, I'll go into that too. But so if we increase the thicknesses more in high latitudes versus the mid latitudes, there are two main effects that I think we can expect to see. If we look at a particular isopleth of the 500 millibar height field, which is schematically shown on this figure here, and you warm the atmosphere more at high latitudes, what you'd expect to find is that the ridges are going to be elongated northward, much more than the troughs changing southward just through general global warming. The effect of that is to make the waves in the 500 millibar field higher amplitude. And we know that when you have higher amplitude waves in the flow, they tend to progress more slowly. And this leads to weather conditions that are more persistent. So this is the first effect. The second effect is that we know we've seen this poleward thickness gradient has decreased. And in fact, in some work that we did a few years ago, we looked at years or summers with less ice than normal compared to years with more ice than normal and how that poleward thickness gradient differed between those two sets of years, starting in the summer and going through all the way till spring. And you can see that both in the North Atlantic and in the North Pacific, the thickness gradient, the poleward thickness gradient was much weaker in the low ice years versus the high ice years. So we have these weaker upper level zonal winds, and we know that weaker zonal winds lead to a slower phase speed of Rossby waves. And again, this is connected with weather conditions that are more persistent. If those waves are moving more slowly, so do the weather patterns. So we're going to dig even a little more deeply here. And the approach we're going to take is to focus in on the, again, the North Atlantic and the over North America, looking at the 500 millibar height fields. And we're going to pick a narrow range of 500 millibar heights that represent the pattern in the 500 millibar height fields. So we're capturing those waves. And we're looking at just those grid points in a particular narrow range of heights and see how they evolve in temporal and spatial or how they behave in the time and space. So let's start with the autumn. And again, we're looking at this narrow range of heights. And I call these my fire plots. We're looking at how these, the number of these grid points versus latitude and time are changing. This is actually the fractional anomalies in those grid points. So a value around one means that it's about normal. And what we can see is those red values north of 50 north or so are increasing as we go forward in time to recent decades. So that suggests that there's an increased ridging north of 50 north. We're getting an increase in those ridges, which is what we expected to find as those ridges elongated northward. We also see that the troughs seem to be decreasing. So at low latitudes, we get a decrease in the number of grid points. So this could be two things. It could either mean that the waves are getting higher amplitude, or the whole pattern could be just shifting northward. So we're going to look at which that is in a very simple analysis, really, starting with just the maximum latitude of where those grid points are, and that's what the top panel is. And you can see that there's a very distinct and significant increase in the maximum latitude of the ridges, starting in about the mid-1980s or so. So we've got a maximum latitude of the ridges increasing. The minimum latitude or the troughs are staying pretty much the same since the 80s. And the difference between them, which is the bottom panel, shows that the amplitude is in fact increasing in the waves. And this is from the reanalysis. So this is what's been happening in the real world. And I've also plotted on there in reverse scale the changes in the sea ice area and correlated that with each of those curves. And you can see that the correlation is really pretty good between the maximum latitude, so the ridges, and also the latitude difference, or the amplitude between the amplitude of the waves. So if we move on to, So we want to also look at how these ridges and trough patterns might be changing in longitude as well, see where they're located. So if we just focus on the grid points that are north of 50 north, and remember from the fire plot, it looked like those were increasing with time, and you plot longitude versus time in a Hofmaller sort of a diagram. So on the western side, the hot colors are where there's the most grid points that are north of 50 north. So you can see that the ridges tend to align along the west coast of the United States, which is what we know to be true, and also along the eastern part of the North Atlantic. And we also can notice that the number of ridge points generally is increasing north of 50 north, especially it looks like over the western U.S. So we can do this exact same analysis for the wintertime. And here's the fire plot for that. And it looks like, again, the number of grid points in the ridges is increasing quite dramatically, almost twice as many in some cases, north of 40 north. And again, we see a decrease in the troughs. And again, we want to look at whether it's actually an increase in the amplitude of the waves. And we'll do the same sorts of plots for the winter. And we see that, indeed, the maximum latitude of those ridges is increasing. The minimum latitude is increasing as well, so the troughs are moving northward in the winter. But we also see a significant latitude difference. So in the wintertime, the amplitude of the waves is increasing as well. So I've also plotted on there the winter AO index, because people have asked me about how it might be related. But interestingly, the correlation to the AO index is really quite low. So it seems that the AO is really not well connected to what's going on here. So we can again look at how the longitudinal behavior of the ridges are evolving with time. And here's the longitude time plot for the ridges north of 40 north now. And you can see again that they're aligned pretty much along the western part of North America and also in the eastern part of the North Atlantic. And again, these are generally increasing with time. So I also wanted to look at the troughs. You can do the same thing and look at the grid points that are south of 40 degrees north. And what we see is the troughs are very well confined to along the east coast in the wintertime, which is, you know, what's consistent with what we understand. And these the troughs are generally getting weaker or less prevalent in the western part of the North America and also less prevalent over in the eastern part of the North Atlantic. So I'm going to summarize now with kind of a schematic of what I think is going on here. So we've got Arctic amplification is clearly happening. We've got the high latitudes warming much faster than the mid-latitudes in the fall and the winter. And this is leading to a weakening of the poleward thickness gradient. So this has two effects, as I mentioned. As you weaken the poleward thickness gradient, you weaken the upper level zonal mean flow, and this reduces the phase speed of the Rossby waves. The other effect is the peaks in the upper level ridges are elongating northward, the wave amplitudes are increasing, and both of these things are contributing to the slower progression of Rossby waves. And we know that as the waves progress more slowly, the weather conditions are going to become more persistent. And this is what we expect to see in terms of what leads to extreme weather, or will be more of a tendency for extreme weather, in particular things like cold spells, flooding, prolonged snowfall, and drought. Now, I mentioned that in the summertime we're seeing a very similar behavior, but of course it's not related to sea ice anymore. We think it's more related to the earlier snowmelt over land, but we're seeing almost exactly the same behavior, and this is what we think is leading more towards the heat waves and the drought. And I want to also mention that I think the increasing amplitude of the waves may also be feeding back to the sea ice, because as we saw in 2007 and 2010, we had a very high amplitude atmospheric pattern in the Arctic. This led to a very persistent wind field that tended to compress the ice and blow the ice out of the Arctic. And so I think this may be another feedback loop back onto the Arctic sea ice. Thank you very much.
We'll take one question for Jennifer. Yes, right in front.
Right. So the question is about how ENSO might be coming into play here. And it's not something I've looked at yet, but I think because it's such a monotonic increase in the number, in the peak latitude of the ridges, for example, we don't see an ENSO-like signal coming out in any of the trends that we're seeing. So I don't know for sure that it's not related, but there's no obvious signal there that it's coming into play. It's much, much closer related to what's going on with the sea ice and the Arctic amplification, it seems.
I think we'll close the session there. Thank you very much, Jennifer. And please join us for our poster session this afternoon. It's also a union session, and we hope to see you there. Thank you very much.